I mean, I just cannot imagine being a celebrity's kid today, where you have to be worried all the time. I mean, at one point, just because we lived so close to Ventura Boulevard, Dad put a sign up, "Beware of guard dog," on our gate. We lived in Encino. Oh, yeah. We had a vine runner. And vine runners aren't usually guard dogs, but he had had Joaquin trained, and Joaquin was from Germany. They were one of the first five pair that came into the country. And some idiot walked through the gate and went over and put his hand on Dodie, who was, I don't know, two maybe. And the dog bit him. I mean, the dog had growled and the guy paid no attention. And I don't know what his intentions were, but Joaquin bit him. And he ended up suing Dad, you know, and there's signs all over the place and everything. And to go touch a kid when you've got a dog growling at you, especially a big dog. Anyway, he lost the case. So, you know, it didn't cost Daddy any money other than for the lawyer to defend. But, you know, that was the only thing I remember. I took a bus. At one point in the eighth grade, I went to school down in the Silver Lake District, and I took public buses. I walked up the street to Ventura Boulevard, and then I had three or four transfers to get from Encino down to Silver Lake, and I did it coming back the same way, twice a day, for about 6 weeks. I hated the school. They didn't like me. And we mutually parted company before I got expelled. And I ended up back at Birmingham again. I mean, I kept telling them that I thought that their school was really dumb. And that, you know, that isn't where I wanted to be. Anyway, usually I was an A student, but I didn't like them. So, but I mean, now I can't imagine even a kid, not a celebrity's kid, trusting a kid to take four transfers down in the middle of Los Angeles to go to school every day. I mean, I wouldn't let a 12 or 13 year old go anywhere without an adult with them. I mean, it's just not safe. And I was doing it by myself.
Yeah, it was totally different.
Yeah. Well, I worked in Dad's fan mail office one summer. That was the first job I had. I was 12 years old. It was down on Highland. And again, I took the bus. And I took the bus from Encino into Ventura and Laurel, where one of the older ladies that worked at the fan mail office would meet me, and I would ride to work with her, other than the couple of times that she got sick and I took the bus all the way down. Wow. So and nobody thought that I couldn't do it or that there was a problem or anything like that.
Interesting. What was a typical day like at the fan mail office?
Crazy. I mean, here they'd been married by the time that I was working at the fan mail office. They'd been married for 5 years, and Mom was still getting hate mail from people that, you know, little girls that she'd married their hero. They were going to marry him when they grew up. And Dad was getting mail from little boys saying, how, you know, get rid of that smooky stuff, you know, and no mush, no kisses, no anything in our movies. And and then I remember Mom getting gifts of fabric from some man, sent her yards and yards and yards of spun gold from India, saris, gold sari cloth that she had made into blouses and stuff. But, oh, it was just beautiful.
The volume, I mean, was it hundreds a day, thousands a day, or...
I don't remember the numbers, but there were like five of us, you know, answering stuff, and we were just running all day long, trying to get through all of this stuff. And all three of Dad's aunts I mean, of Dad's sisters, rather, my aunts. All three of his sisters worked in the fan mail at one time or another.
Wow.
And one of my cousins, Diane, worked there also after me. She's younger than I am. But,
would you write back personal letters to all of them and then sign Roy or Dale's name, or would they sign it? How would,
Mainly notes
mm-hmm.
or pictures, and Dad already had his signature mm-hmm. on the pictures.
Oh, I see.
Yeah.
So, and then would you type them up or handwrite the letters?
I wasn't typing at 12.
Okay.
No, they were handwritten.
Secretary Trent.
Yeah. Yeah, no, they were handwritten.
Handwritten.
Although I must say, I had been to convent there at Villa Caprini, so my handwriting was very legible. Mm-hmm. The nuns saw to that.
Would you guys have to pretend to be them writing back, or would you be writing back as their fan mail representative or whatever? Do you remember? I'm just curious how that worked.
I think it depended
uh-huh.
upon what it was
yeah.
and all. You know, usually it was just thank you for your letter
yeah.
and then enclose the picture with the signature
right.
on it. So the ones that demanded, I think, a more personalized answer and all, they were answered by Dad's secretary or somebody.
So
that wasn't anything I did.
He had a secretary.
Oh, yeah.
And your mom had a secretary?
Yes.
Okay.
Mom hired a secretary, not in the beginning, not when they were first married or anything. It was after she started with her books
mm-hmm.
that she hired her on secretary. I think Tom and Barbara, my older brother and his wife, used to answer a lot of Mom's fan mail in the beginning
oh, wow.
when they were first married. Because Tommy was mentioning it. We were together recently, and he mentioned something about, you know, about having been the one that opened and answered a lot of her stuff.
Yeah. And there was a Hanson in later years that worked for your dad or something like that, a lady, I remember talking to her.
Oh, Francie.
Francie Hanson. Was it Hanson was her last name?
There
was
Francie Williams.
Oh, I thought there was a Hanson somewhere along the line.
Hmm. Well, Bill Hanson was their minister.
Oh, okay.
Reverend Hanson was their minister, and he was just an incredible man. Yeah, he was their minister from the day they moved to Apple Valley, I think, until he buried them.
Well, let me ask you some more about these people here. Now, Pat Brady, how did he get the part on the show, on the TV show? And was that like, natural? He should get it, your dad, your mom, do you know?
Well, Pat worked as a funny guy even when Gabby was still Dad's sidekick.
Mm-hmm.
In fact, some of the funniest scenes, I think, in some of Daddy's films were Gabby and Pat playing off of each other. One in particular comes to mind when they're in a car and Pat hands Gabby the steering wheel because they've been fighting over which direction to go in. And Pat did a lot of comic bits while the Sons of the Pioneers were in Dad's movies. Then when the Pioneers left Republic, he was gone for a while, but they still did fairs and rodeos and stuff together. So I think that when Dad was casting the TV show, it was just a natural for him, you know, to ask Pat first. And Dad had already had the idea for the Jeep because he had a Willie's secondhand war Jeep.
Uh-huh.
And Dad loved driving it around. And he said whenever he would go by an intersection or anything, the kids, you know, if kids were around, oh, look at the Jeep. And so Dad realized that this was sort of fascinating. And the TV Roy Rogers show was a modern Western,
mm-hmm.
so they knew there was going to be cars and stuff in it, and he didn't want to put the sidekick on a burro or something, you know, like that. That had all been done
yeah.
umpteen times, and he got the idea for the Jeep. So he and Pat talked about it and worked it out, and you know.
And how did do you know how the name came across, Nellie Bell?
I don't remember.
Mm-hmm.
No, I don't remember that one.
And then we have Bullet. Now, how did Bullet get in there?
Well, he came into the movies.
Uh-huh.
So he was already there when Dad transitioned into the TV stuff. And who had the original idea, I don't know. But he, not the same bullet, but a bullet was in several of the movies. I think maybe the last dozen or so movies, they had a bullet.
And then the bullet translated into the TV show. Now, that bullet, did you...
That one Daddy bought.
He did buy that bullet.
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, so...
So did Bullet live with you off the...
No, just like Trigger didn't live with us until he retired. You know, with an animal like that that's so highly trained and all, they need to be worked with on like a daily basis. And Daddy didn't have the time to do that. And of course, with kids being all over the place, we would have spoiled the dog rotten. We did the other dogs. We did his coon hounds. He used to get really ticked at us. So, you know, that just didn't happen. Now, when the series was over, then Bullet moved into the house. And he moved with them up to Apple Valley. And even now Trigger passed away just before the museum opened. And he's buried at a ranch they had out in Hidden Valley. Or no, Trigger's in the museum, I'm sorry. Little Trigger also died just before the move to Apple Valley. And he is buried out there where Daddy, Trigger died July 3rd. And Daddy had him mounted and put in the museum. But Buttermilk and Trigger Jr. made the move out to the museum, and they had stalls, and they went in and out all day long. So people that came into the museum, you know, got to pet the horses and see the horses and all. And so that was wonderful with the first museum, yeah.
And Trigger was, I mean, Bullet was around then too, or had Bullet passed away?
No, he was still, they still had Bullet at home, but they never took him over, you know, where the horses would stay behind the rail, you know. Dog would have gone over it.
Yeah.
So, yeah, Daddy kept him at home.
Now, Gabby Hayes, I heard that he was a very serious, intelligent.
Oh, yeah.
Very intelligent, thoughtful man. Tell me a little bit about him.
Oh, he was incredible. Dad loved him. I just absolutely loved the man. And Mom and Dad both credit him with having been the best mentor that an actor could have. Because he really liked them, and they really liked him. He was the ultimate professional actor. He had played Hamlet at 19. He was from New York. He'd had this great career there, and he had retired when the stock market crashed. He was married to a former Ziegfeld girl, and it was her idea that they move to the West Coast and he try movies. The first ones you can see him in are still a couple of silents, but the talkies were coming in. He was right about 40, I believe, at that point. And he had been a leading man on Broadway and in plays, and I don't think the movies knew quite what to do with him. He had this gorgeous speaking voice, just beautiful voice. So they cast him as the banker. They cast him as the head of the rustlers. They did all kinds of things. And she, Mama, hated him being a bad guy, just hated it. And she was the only critic he ever listened to, was his wife. So he remembered this old character he'd seen in vaudeville, this old miner. And so he started using that character and building on it. So when he went to work with Hoppy, he became Wendy Holiday, and that's where the Gabby character was really born for him. When he left the Hoppy series, he was going to take the name with him since he'd created this character out of whole cloth. And they said, oh, no, you can't. We copyrighted it. So he said, okay. And he became Gabby Whitaker instead of George Hayes. And kept developing that character. So, I mean, he was everybody's favorite leading man. I never saw him stumble for a line.
It's more that he actually had his teeth removed so that he could do the old.
Oh, of course not. He had his teeth removed because his teeth were bad.
Oh, okay.
You know, this was in the old days. Yeah, but I mean, this was in the old days, before dentistry is what it is now and all. And when his teeth got bad, he had plates made. But he, being the consummate actor, he used that. That became another prop, you know, in his, yeah, in his repertoire. And love to tell about he and Margaret Dumont working together, because when Mom, when she first came into Dad's movies, Gabby, they had taken Gabby out of Dad's movies, and he was working with Bill Elliott, and he worked with Bill Elliott for like a year and a half or 2 years. And then by that time, Mom had been hired and she'd worked with Dad for like a year, and Gabby came back and they were doing this film that Margaret Dumont was in. And Mom said that Gabby, Mom and Margaret had a scene together, and Gabby afterwards got all over Mom. He says, "Don't let her do that, daughter. Don't let her do that to you." And Mom is saying, "Do what to me?" Because Mom hadn't a clue. But Margaret Dumont had made all of those Marx Brothers films. Mm-hmm. And Gabby says, "Well, she was standing in your light. And she made you turn your head. And she did this. And she did that." He says, "Don't let her do that to you." And Mom says, you know, she's standing there just happy and dumb, you know, not having realized anything. Then Margaret and Gabby had a scene together. Mm-hmm. And he says, "Daughter, watch this." And when you see it on screen, I mean, it is a lesson that every aspiring actor and actress should have to watch that clip. You know, I wish I could off the top of my head, but I can't. But, you know, you can get it on IMDb, the one that Margaret, I think Margaret Dumont only made the one with him.
Okay, we got to look at that here.
And, but they do everything. Twitch their nose, raise their eyebrow, put a shoulder in, take the shoulder out, put their hand up, and I mean, just everything to get the camera and the audience's attention on them. And Mom said it was a primer. Just
amazing.
Yeah. Now, he never had kids, and he was so great with us kids. He just was another grandfather and a lovely, lovely man. Very sophisticated off. He left Gabby at the studio or at the personal appearance. His shirts were made in London. They were silk. His suits were tweed that were made in London. He smoked a pipe. His beard was always trimmed. He was the most sophisticated man I ever knew.
Amazing.
I mean, yeah. I mean, he was a marvelous actor.
Wow.
A marvelous actor.
Amazing.
Yeah.
And you think of all the people your dad worked with, that he was the sort of like the close, like Pat Buttram was, I think, with Gene Autry.
Yeah.
Did they often talk to each other through the years afterwards?
Oh, yeah. They kept in touch. Mm-hmm. Their interests were so diverse that, you know, it wasn't anything. Gabby didn't hunt or fish with Daddy. And I don't remember him being in any of the card games or anything like that. But I know that he and his wife would have dinner with Mom and Dad out. I mean, children were not part of that. They went out and had food, I'm sure a little wine, because Gabby was quite a connoisseur, I understand.